see trees of green, red roses too. Welcome to Childhood Cancer Talk Radio, powered by Jack's Angels, where we talk about your experiences, advocacy news, research, and today's heroes for kids. We are here to bring hope to the unthinkable but real experience of a child diagnosed with cancer. Jack's Angels' advocacy mission is to provide a voice for children with cancer, to effect change for a more hopeful future for those to come. Childhood Cancer Talk Radio starts right now. Here is your host, Janet Demeter.
Welcome to Childhood Cancer Talk Radio. I'm Janet Demeter, your host, and our show today is dedicated to CureFest, the event, the childhood cancer awareness movement, and learning more about its origins, how it's grown, and what the future may hold. And I'm visiting today with Emily Belcher in Ashburn, Virginia. She's an advocate, a mother of a child who has survived cancer, CureFest volunteer and event planner, who has seen CureFest at its first gathering in our nation's capital in 2013, and previous to that as a small gathering in Virginia the year before. From there, Arms Wide Open and the Truth 365 have become household names in the childhood cancer community. And to our listeners, if you're unfamiliar with them, we hope to learn more about them from our guests today and their swift rise and powerful role in the childhood cancer awareness movement, which is today a force to be reckoned with. Right? So here on Childhood Cancer Talk Radio, we work to provide a platform from which families, advocates, caregivers, researchers, and organizations can have a stronger voice and a wider reach in our community. If you have an important story to share, an issue to report, or an experience with which you would like advice or commentary, write to us at cctalkradio@gmail.com. That's cctalkradio@gmail.com. And so now, with no further ado, it's my pleasure to introduce Emily Belcher to our show today. Emily, welcome to Childhood Cancer Talk Radio.
Thank you so much, Janet.
How are you today? How's the East Coast?
Oh, we're doing great. We're having a heat wave for some reason, so it does not feel like fall in any way, shape, or form.
Really? Wow. Yeah, we're getting, you know, the usual fall stuff, so...
I'm ready. We're ready for jeans and sweaters here, but everybody's in shorts and t-shirts.
That's funny. I know. I was looking at, you know, it's election week, guys, so we're all watching each other. I was noticing that people were in shorts there, and I'm like, wait a minute, isn't it November?
It doesn't feel right by any means.
So we've just gotten over this whirlwind of CureFest in September, and then because you are an event planner, you had even more things to contend with after that. So we're catching you now after things have wound down a bit from probably one of the busiest seasons of the year for you, right?
Absolutely, yes. Especially on the East Coast in the Northern Virginia, D.C. area, September is a very busy event month, but as you said, it's also big for childhood cancer. It was Childhood Cancer Awareness Month, so that's when we always have CureFest weekend. So it's a big undertaking, but it's a lot of fun.
Well, would you tell us a little bit about that? I know just briefly, I touched on it before with you, but the very first time that people got together in planning this, you said it wasn't in D.C., but it was in Virginia. Is that right?
Yes, that's correct. The first time that CureFest ever really came together, it was in the suburbs of Northern Virginia. It was a smaller event, and the goal was sort of to gather together some of the childhood cancer foundations that had started over the years. One of the largest challenges with childhood cancer is that, tragically, many people start foundations in memory of their children, or they do it to celebrate the successes of their children's health. But that means that there's thousands of small childhood cancer foundations, and so getting all of those foundations to work together in order to create change for these kids, whether it's medical treatments or better outcomes long term for them, it's hard because all these small voices are speaking individually instead of as one voice, if you will. So the first CureFest was in 2011, and then there was actually a break in 2012, and then it really started to come together again in 2013.
And was that where you first came in, or were you privy to those first meetings?
Well, my daughter was diagnosed with brain cancer, specifically PNET brain cancer, in November of 2012. And I'm kind of embarrassed to say, but before that, I really had very little exposure to pediatric cancer. I had very little knowledge about it. I had no idea what these kids went through. And then, of course, when your child is diagnosed, you're thrown into this world, and you have to learn quickly, and you become an advocate immediately, but you have so many things to learn and so many organizations to experience. So it took about a year for me to get my feet under me, but in the fall of 2013, I attended the first CureFest. It was an amazing experience for me to know that a lot of foundations were out there and advocates were already out there who had sort of paved the road for me and my family, if you will. In fact, Janet, you're one of them. You had already, I hate to say, had already been down that road with Jack. And so, you know, I was grateful to know that there were other families and organizations out there who were already aware of what she had been through.
But you know what? It's like that, isn't it? We just don't know. We don't know it until it happens to us. It's not something that's widely spoken of or talked about. And it's hard as a small voice or even collectively to be noticed. That's why it's so important we work together, right?
It is. It's also, I think one of the hardest things about it is that it's very sad. And so when you have a cause like this that is so hard for people to really look in the eyes of, it's hard to motivate people because they get, it's very tragic, and it's hard to continue forward motion when everybody feels so sad about what's happening.
Absolutely. No, I can relate to that. I mean, I came into it, I know myself, as a parent, after my son had passed, and, you know, wanted to start something. There was so little. We did have a foundation in our area that provided support for families, with which we could, I don't know how we would have made it through. And actually, the Michael Hofflin Foundation, which is in Santa Clarita, California, they actually, if it weren't for their support and their love and camaraderie and just them being a constant presence, I don't know if I would be continuing with what I'm doing now. I mean, isn't it true that so much of our health and our growth is dependent upon the support of others? And when it's not there, it's like, oh, it's very difficult.
And I find it so inspiring that you took those experiences and those, you know, moments from that particular group and that foundation that supported you, and you've turned it into something great, which is really the beautiful thing about the childhood cancer community, is that despite there being many foundations and with many different goals, they are doing great things. They really are. Whether it's a program to support a child going through treatment, or a family that could use help with gas money because they're traveling a ton for treatments, or whether it's direct support to a medical research program or a doctor who's doing something innovative, they all have something so valuable to do, and they are very inspiring. It's just that with so many of them, it's hard to make great change.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And I think it's symptomatic also of just the state of affairs. I mean, pediatric cancer research, and we wouldn't be doing what we do as advocates if this weren't the case, but pediatric cancer research has been largely neglected because, you know, it's not, it's generally marketplace principles that govern for the most part how this research gets funding. Unfortunately, it seems to be that way with our government resources as well. But It's that's what we have to work with. And so, you know, anytime you're working on improving something or making changes, it's hard. There's this wall of inertia you have to get through. And it's not to say that the current system is bad or it's anyone's fault or anything like that. It's just, hello, we have a need here. Could we rearrange things a little bit to support these folks who aren't getting help?
Yeah, absolutely.
But, you know, with childhood cancer, emotions run high. And as you said, it's sad. No one likes to think about it. So those are extra challenges that we have. But, okay, so back to the first CureFest where you were. Can you tell us a little bit about what the experience was like for you?
And, sure. It was neat in one respect because it was set up right on the National Mall at the Washington Monument. And when you're standing in that location, the White House is, depending on what direction you're facing, is right there in front of you. So if you have your back to the monument and you're staring at the White House, you sort of feel like you're part of something because so many movements have started right there in Washington, D.C. on the Mall. So there were, I don't know, probably 20, 25, maybe a few more childhood cancer foundations, and they had tents set up, and you could visit each booth, if you will, and learn about what each foundation did, upcoming events that they were hosting, and other places you could learn about the current medical research, that type of thing. And then there was also a small stage, which the performances at CureFest have always been really special, and they've always been part of a very specific goal on behalf of the planning committee, which is to give children a voice, too. So at every CureFest, including the early ones, children are welcome to the stage, and we have had the most amazing dance performances and singing performances. Dance teams from the local Virginia area come.
Yes.
And it's really special. In fact,
Sorry, we have to take a quick break, but I want to come back to this right after the break. This is Childhood Cancer Talk Radio. We're on toginet.com. Please stay with us. We'll be right back after these messages from our Toginet sponsors.
Stay tuned. Janet will be right back with more on Childhood Cancer Talk Radio, where kids come first for the cure.
The League of Women Voters reminds you that on Election Day, we are all equal. Please join your friends and neighbors by registering to vote and going to the polls November 8th. Visit www.vote411.org to find out who will be on your ballot and how the voting process works in your community. This election is about our future, and we all need to weigh in.
It's words you never heard.
Got a lead foot? According to state troopers, here's what not to do when you get pulled over. Don't be a lachrymous and start crying right away. It doesn't help. But if you're under 20, crying won't be held against you. Don't ask for a break, and don't yell or start any argy-bargy. And one trooper said, if they're going to flirt with me to get out of a ticket, it would probably insult my intelligence. But unfortunately, I don't get hit on all that often. So flirting or being a gill flirt won't work. Did you know that 15% of all drivers get 76% of all traffic tickets? And the odds of winning if you challenge a traffic ticket in court are 1 in 3. So what should you do when you get pulled over for speeding? Be courteous to the officer and most of all, be honest.
It's words you never heard.
I'm Carolyn Davidson, and you can have fun challenging your words you never heard vocabulary with my free app, Too Funny for Word.
Welcome back to to more great conversation on Childhood Cancer Talk Radio, because every child's life deserves hope. Here's Janet.
Welcome back to Childhood Cancer Talk Radio on toginet.com, where we're talking today with Emily Belcher from Ashburn, Virginia, about CureFest and her experience as an advocate for children with cancer and also participating in the event. And before the break, we were talking about, Emily was telling us about the portion of CureFest where the kids get up and perform. Could you take that away for us again a little bit?
I had to. Sure, no problem.
Okay.
I think I was saying one of the really special parts about CureFest, which has continued since 2013, is that we always have a stage where children can come and perform. They perform in support of each other, but we also often have children with cancer who will come and perform. Particularly here in Northern Virginia, we have a lot of very talented children who've been diagnosed with cancer and have still really made so much of their fine arts career, whether by dancing or singing. And then the other very difficult part of that is a lot of children who get up and speak or perform, we find that they actually don't survive for another full year until the next CureFest. So it's amazing to have those children on video or to have photos of them or have recordings of them speaking, and then basically the following year where they're advocating in their memory. So it's an amazing event.
Well, you know, I first started following, there was a young girl, Erin Griffin, from Australia, who I started following. It was towards the end of her journey. She'd already been to CureFest, so it was 2014 when I learned about her. It was like early in the year. But I know that both she and Gabriella Miller, right, were there in 2013. They were kind of like our founding, they seem like, at least for all practical purposes in the bigger world, you know, people that we remember seeing at the beginning, it was really Erin and Gabriella that were key, some of our key founding child advocates for this movement.
Yes, that was actually the same year, in 2013 is when I met Gabriella as well, and I have shared with her mom, I was just so taken with her. I met her during the event, and obviously there was a recording of her speaking that so many people saw, and she was just a powerful, amazing little girl, an amazing force to be reckoned with. It's a huge loss to the world that those girls are no longer here, and I know their parents work so hard still, as you do, in their memory and for other children, which I'm always really amazed by.
Definitely. I remember Erin, I was looking forward to hopefully meeting her. And I think she died the beginning of that September 2014.
She did.
And it just broke my heart. And then when I, you know, it was my first CureFest that I went to in 2014. And I went for the week and wanted to visit with, you know, congressional representatives and leaders and so on. And then I didn't understand the timing of it, and my flight came back like Sunday morning. And so I missed, there was this gorgeous dance that Erin's dance friend, because Erin had been a very talented dancer, had come and done. The video is available, but I remember that was just heart-wrenching. If you Google that, you can find it.
Right, and then that was also the year, actually, that Erin's mom came from Australia, and Gabriella's mom was there with her, and those two women were up on the stage, and they shaved their heads together, which was extremely moving for everybody who watched that happen. These very brave, beautiful women were up there in honor of their daughters. It was very moving.
Wow. That's amazing.
It was.
Yeah, that was the first year that that I went, and I noticed between then and even the next year, quite a shift. A shift in, I remember when I first went, there was still, that was the year when people were, or maybe it was the next year, when people were sending the whole More Than Four campaign into the NCI. If you're listening out there, only 4% of the government, our federal government with the National Cancer Institute, their resources for cancer research annually, only 4% benefits pediatric research specific, and that's pediatric cancer as a whole, which is, you know, a big pot of things. And so the advocacy community has been very upset about that for a while, and it's always been kind of a focus of the event, has it not?
Absolutely. Education is a huge part of the event. We want it to be a family-friendly event, and we want it to be a day for, you know, people to come together to learn about childhood cancer. But that advocacy and education is really important, because if people don't understand why we're upset about the funding, then they won't realize the need to join into the conversation. So the lack of funding that is focused specifically on childhood cancer is a very big deal.
And probably one of the toughest things to convey to people who aren't immediately affected by it is why it's so important for them, because we're all so connected. And you don't really realize that until it happens to you or someone you love. And the reason why it's important to safeguard against that is, of course, because we still don't know what causes it.
Right.
It can happen to anyone at any time.
Yes, it can. And as you learned with Jack, some of the different types of childhood cancer that can appear out of nowhere, with no predictors, no family history, no nothing, there is not a cure. And so the fact that we have our children and they have their whole lives ahead of them, and then one day you're sitting in a doctor's office out of the blue and you're told, we're sorry, there's no treatment for your child, is so unacceptable. But that tragedy, until you're sitting in front of it, you're not motivated by it, which is sort of a harsh thing to say, but until it's your child, you don't realize how urgent it is.
Right. And then you want your, I know for myself that I'm motivated so that, you know, I don't want indefinitely in the future people having to be able, having to experience that, having to hear that, oh, we don't have anything for your child. Because I would ask a lot of questions. I'd ask industry people. It's always the numbers aren't great enough for investors, that it's not worth the investment. And it was like, excuse me. Then when you find out after your child is gone that, wow, what he had, it wasn't so rare. That's actually one of the number one killers of kids with cancer. And how long has that been around? Oh, 50 years, really? You know, you get a little angry, you get a little, you know, jilted. But more than that, you want to do something for others. If there's no more hope for you, but you can still change the odds for someone else. And that makes me feel worth my oxygen if I could do that. So, yeah, talking about the motivation behind it. So you were very motivated having your daughter. Gosh, were you in mid-treatment when she went to her first CureFest?
When Carolyn was diagnosed, we were actually living in Kentucky for a couple of years, and she was not able to travel at the time. She had finished formal treatment by August of 2013, but she was still not strong enough to travel or to be away from her oncology team, if you will. So I went to the first couple CureFests on my own, primarily also because I was working. I'm a volunteer for the event. I'm the walk coordinator for CureFest. But as you sort of indicated in the introduction, I also work at the event as an event coordinator. We do the permitting for the National Mall, and I manage all the vendors who bring in the tents and the tables and the chairs and things like that. So, Caroline didn't attend CureFest until this year for the first time because
wow.
we are finally living back in Northern Virginia now. And she was thrilled. She was so excited to be there. And in fact, I have two other boys, and they were there for the first time as well. So it was a fun event. And we are lucky enough to have a huge support system here in Northern Virginia. Before Kentucky, I lived here in Northern Virginia for about 15 years. So a lot of Team Caroline, if you will, is here, and they have come to CureFest for years and years, with or without her. And so it's always amazing to me to see all of these people turn out in support of my daughter, and childhood cancer awareness. So she loved it this year, and I'm looking forward to bringing her for many more years.
That's wonderful. Tell us a little bit about, and then we're going to go to break. But before we go to break, could you introduce a little bit what she had? It's called PNET. That's the letters PNET, correct?
That's correct, yes. It's primitive neuroectodermal tumors. And they're very closely related to medulloblastoma, which is another type of brain cancer. So they're solid tumors, and she had basically hundreds of them throughout her brain and spine when she was diagnosed.
Oh, my goodness. Wow.
It was puzzling. There was no one. Most kids with brain cancer have one large tumor, with solid tumors, have one large tumor in their brain, and then if you don't catch it in time, it metastasizes throughout their brain and spine. Caroline did not have one large tumor anywhere, which was something that puzzled the doctors originally, and it took them 3 weeks to diagnose her because they saw all these small tumors everywhere, but they didn't know they were tumors because they didn't present the right way. So it was challenging.
Wow.
She started with the full team of hazmat suit type people, like the ET version of like her in the hospital room and everybody breathing through masks. And as they started doing more tests, and they would send samples of her brain tissue and brain fluid and all over the country, they were sending samples of my daughter and trying to diagnose her. They would peel off a layer.
We'll be right back. You're listening to Childhood Cancer Talk Radio, where kids come first, for the cure on toginet.com. Don't go away.
Stay tuned. Janet will be right back with more on Childhood Cancer Talk Radio, where kids come first for the cure.
Information about book publishing is power. The power to change your authoring life. And the power to change the lives of your readers. So join us for Your Guide to Book Publishing, Everything You Want to Know But Didn't Know What to Ask, with your host, Dr. Judith Bryles. Thursdays at 6 p.m. Eastern, 3 Pacific, you'll hear about statistics, scenarios, and strategies on what to do now. As the book shepherd, Dr. Judith Bryles is in. And each week, she will include publishing professionals that will reveal tips and secrets to the author's journey. If there is a book in you, you want to listen, learn, and yes, call in with your questions each week. For more on Judith and what she can do for you, check out her website, thebookshepherd.com. It's Your Guide to Book Publishing, Everything You Want to Know But Didn't Know What to Ask. Brought to you by Author You and The Book Shepherd, with your host, Dr. Judith Bryles. Thursday evenings at 6 p.m. Eastern, 3 p.m. Pacific.
It's Marching Never Hurt.
Got a lead foot? According to state troopers, here's what not to do when you get pulled over. Don't be a lachrymous and start crying right away. It doesn't help. But if you're under 20, crying won't be held against you. Don't ask for a break, and don't yell or start any argy-bargy. And one trooper said, if they're going to flirt with me to get out of a ticket, it would probably insult my intelligence. But unfortunately, I don't get hit on all that often. So flirting or being a gill flirt won't work. Did you know that 15% of all drivers get 76% of all traffic tickets? And the odds of winning if you challenge a traffic ticket in court are 1 in 3. So what should you do when you get pulled over for speeding? Be courteous to the officer, and most of all, be honest.
It's Marching Never.
I'm Carolyn Davidson, and you can have fun challenging your words you never heard vocabulary with my free app, Too Funny for Words.
Welcome back to more great conversation on Childhood Cancer Talk Radio, because every child's life deserves hope. Here's Janet.
And we're back again with Childhood Cancer Talk Radio. And I just have to note here that it's brought to you in part by Jack's Angels Foundation for Pediatric Brain Tumor Awareness and Research on the web at www.jacksangels.org. And this is the portion of the show where we have a little news, updates, or other advocacy information. And today I'm just going to begin by reminding all of us the main reason we're on the air, and that is because cancer is the leading cause of death in children in the United States, disease-related, that is, yet it remains one of the least funded areas of cancer research. And unfortunately, our federal government does not step in as far as you think it should, supporting those most vulnerable citizens that are neglected for the most part in the private sector. Childhood cancer research is not seen as an immediately profitable investment by most big corporations who invest in medical research with the desired end of creating a drug to be marketed on a large scale. So there is also, of course, merit in, you know, investing in a cure, which invariably brings new industry jobs and so forth. But, you know, usually we're, even our, the big guys go paycheck to paycheck and quarterly to quarterly. And if we're going to make a dent in this, we need to start doing things not only on the incentive end, which a lot of our current childhood legislation that's up for grabs right now supports, but also we need to give our government a nudge and say, hey, you know, how about those that are, you know, facing almost certain death and our youngest ones being important factors in the equation when you give out your research grants with NCI. So all of those things are very, very possible and have been thought of and drawn up in the legislation. So I can't suggest highly enough to all of you out there who are civic-minded and gung-ho on expressing your full First Amendment rights and your rights as a citizen to let your representative know what you want, to please go to our website, jacksangels.org, go to the advocacy page, and there is actually, you can actually read the text of some of these bills there. And another good source, a very good resource for advocacy, is if you go to Kids v. Cancer, that's like Kids Versus Cancer, kidsvcancer.org. That's Nancy Goodman's site. She's an amazing force to be reckoned with. We have so many forces to be reckoned with on this show today. In the advocacy world, she knows her stuff. She was instrumental in the Creating Hope Act, which creates vouchers and incentives in the private sector for investment in pediatric research. Excuse me. At any rate, all these things are very important. If you hold on just one moment, if you could tell us about the Gabriella Miller Kids First Act for a minute.
Absolutely. So as we mentioned earlier, Gabriella was one of the kids who attended CureFest in years past, and she sadly passed away from DIPG, which is an extremely aggressive type of cancer. And her parents have worked tirelessly since she passed away. And one of the greatest things that came out of it is the Gabriella Miller Kids First Research Act. And it's interesting right now, certainly because of the political arena that we're all sitting in. But basically, the Gabriella Miller Act, it terminated taxpayer funding for the major party conventions. It took the money that the taxpayer money that used to go to the conventions and is redirecting it toward pediatric cancer research.
I had no idea about that.
It's great. It's great. It's great. There's some really spectacular photos of President Obama signing that with Gabriella's family there. And they have continued to work toward refining that and continuing that action since it was signed. So being here in D.C., we all talk a lot about the federal funding at NIH for pediatric cancer, but there are people doing amazing things to try and increase funding from other directions as well, which is awesome.
Definitely. And people listening, you can hear from Ellen Miller. She was on one of our first shows. I believe it's the 21st of January show of this year. If you go on toginet.com and look under shows, go to Childhood Cancer Talk Radio. You can find all of our podcasts there available for download. And I was just telling Emily during the break that I was hoping to have Ellen and Amanda, who's Erin Griffin's mom, I'm hoping to have them on the show to talk about, you know, the beginnings of CureFest in Australia, because out of this that we began here, right, was it from that 2013 year? I think the next year... Amanda began that. Is that right?
I want to say that this actually was the first year that that Australia really started their own, or maybe the beginnings of it came last year. Because I know her mom attended CureFest,
right?
But I do know that this year they had a very strong following, and they're hoping to continue that for many years to come.
Yeah, which is great. It's really, really important. I think it's becoming a much stronger worldwide movement. And now with the Truth 365 putting out, they put out a film this year. Wasn't it Emmy Award winning?
Yes, it's amazing. Mike Gillette puts out so much valuable information, photos, videos of children through social media as part of the Truth 365. Anyone who is interested in those things, they can go to the Truth 365 Facebook page and find just the most incredible videos. And Mike goes and he builds these relationships with the children, and he finds them in their places of strength. So whether they are dancers or there's something in particular that they love doing, he goes and he spends time with them and really gets to know them, and he gives them a voice. And I think that's so valuable, because so many people, as we sort of talked about earlier, they look away. Children going through cancer treatment are not, you know, necessarily the images that many people are comfortable with. They find it uncomfortable to see a child with tubes coming out of them or in a hospital bed, because, again, they find it so sad. But Mike goes and he finds every beautiful part of those children, and he captures it in the most amazing ways.
Wow. Well, we need to support. And he was instrumental in beginning this whole thing, was he not?
He was. The Truth 365 and Arms Wide Open were part of the very first CureFest in 2011.
Wow. My son was diagnosed October 28th in 2011.
Oh, wow.
And I didn't even really realize this whole world out there until, gosh, almost a year had gone by, at least. Some of these cancers are extremely isolating. DIPG being almost completely universally fatal, still, unfortunately, you don't, it's not really something you want to jump up and down and share, especially when you're, you know, told all these dismal statistics and really not encouraged, at least at the time. Things are actually changing, which is really cool.
Yeah.
But at the time, we weren't like hugely encouraged to seek out any other help. If I wanted to, we did many alternative therapies with him. They were always asking us, well, let us know how that goes, because of course we're not allowed to do that. So,
right.
So we did the same.
We sought out some of those as well. I remember I gave Caroline a supplement for pretty much the entire time she went through chemo and radiation, and I got the doctor's approval to give it to her, but it was very much like, okay, well, Hope that helps.
Yeah, right.
I don't know. It's very much left up to parents to try and do the best we can. I mean, chemo and radiation are so brutal to their little bodies, and that's all we've got. and it causes so many side effects. And so even people with no experience in alternative medicine, like myself, maybe you felt the same way. I didn't know anything, but I was willing to try anything that seemed safe for her. You feel like a crazy person looking into all of that stuff, but then you realize it's your child, and you would do anything crazy for them.
Of course, and that's the difficulty of you know, being a parent of a child with cancer. That's another thing we hope to change eventually someday. You don't feel like you have to become an expert in naturopathic medicine overnight. Or, there's some really cool things out there, but any data? No. Any guidance in using them? It's very hard to find guidance in using some of these therapies. And so you're truly, truly on your own. And I hope that someday that there's a little more, there should be more regulation in that. There should be more, possibilities for people. But at any rate, when we're going to take another break pretty soon here in another minute or so. But when we come back, I want to discuss again, because we had started talking about the experience you had with your daughter when she was first diagnosed and how, unlike with other pediatric brain tumors or central nervous system ailments, that she had little tumors everywhere, right?
She did.
That must have been extremely disconcerting.
It was. There were so many of them, the doctors didn't even count them.
Wow. Well, when we come back from the break, I'd like to discuss with you a little more about how CureFest is today, what the political climate is like from your point of view, how much has it changed? And we have an uncertain future with an unknown administration, at least this week. Next week we'll know.
That's another radio show.
Right? So I'm Janet Demeter, your host of Childhood Cancer Talk Radio. I'm talking with Emily Belcher today of Ashburn, Virginia. We're talking about CureFest, and we'll be back just after these messages from our TogiNet sponsors.
Stay tuned. Janet will be right back with more on Childhood Cancer Talk Radio, where kids come first for the cure.
Would you like to know how to bring more ease to all the decisions you need to make in life? Knowing your core values is the first step in Joyce's free live masterclass. You'll discover your top 5 core values in as little as 45 minutes. Join her now at freegiftfromjoyce.com.
Summertime, and you know what that means. Attack of the mosquitoes. Other names for the mosquito are Galley Nipper, Katy Nipper, Gabber Napper, and Galley Whopper. A quote from the 1906 book The Parsons Boys asserts that Galley Nippers are so called because at each nip they took a gallon. Mitzi is a deceptively cute shortening of mosquito that might be heard in Ohio. If you're in Virginia and hear someone complaining about cousins, they might have annoying relatives, or they might just be talking about mosquitoes. Why do they call mosquitoes cousins? Because there are so many and they stick so close. But whatever you call them, all this begs the question, why didn't Noah swat those two mosquitoes?
It's Martin Denver.
I'm Carolyn Davidson, and you can have fun challenging your words you never heard vocabulary with my free app, Too Funny for Word.
Welcome back to more great conversation on Childhood Cancer Talk Radio, because every child's life deserves hope. Here's Janet.
And we're back again talking about CureFest today. We've talked a lot about the whole reason that we're here on the air discussing something so important as childhood cancer awareness. And again, it's because, unless you've unfortunately had to be directly in contact with this issue, you don't realize it. So little funding goes to pediatric cancer research, so that when it does, and it does, it's not if, it happens to thousands every year, okay? And I'm sure Emily could give better statistics than I have off the top of my head, but we're, 16-some thousand kids a year, diagnosed a whole classroom full every day, are diagnosed with cancer. You know, and that could be, if you're lucky, there's no lucky cancer, but we've spent a lot of money on adult research for leukemia. So as a result, the statistics overall of cancer per se, which is a huge conglomerate of diseases, right, has, survival rates have improved. 1 out of 5 die, they say. But with the leading cause of cancer-related death in children, which has for quite some time been the brain tumors, pediatric brain tumors. And now, just recently in Scientific American and the CDC have said that DIPG is the number one killer. I didn't know that. I know it was responsible for 80% of those deaths, but now they're saying that. But anyway, the brain tumors have been neglected for a long time. And as a result, when you're thrown into it, you're in the situation where you don't know if your child's going to survive, even if it's a good cancer, and I don't know what that is, but but it's a horrible place to be, whether you're an adult or a child. But for the children, these kids haven't had lifestyle issues yet to bring them on. We don't know why a lot of these happened. We're only just learning. So this is why it's so important that people know. This issue doesn't come hurling from a void. That we have systematically over time neglected our kids with cancer, and it needs to change. And so my guest today, Emily, has been very generous in telling us about her experience with her daughter and how that progressed and where we left off. You just had this diagnosis, something really scary. You'd never heard of it before, had you?
No. Oh, my gosh, no. In fact, I for the longest time, I couldn't even pronounce it. It was
right.
So silly to me, but well, that's just the type of things that these kids are diagnosed with. Some of them are very complicated.
Right. And it's a shock. It's a huge shock to your system. We were talking, during the break, Emily and I, and, she's asking me about, do you ever consider, PTSD type of issues or symptoms? And I'm like, oh yeah. oh yeah. You're not sure if your child is going to die or not. And all of a sudden, oh yes, you can try XYZ, in the natural medicine world. We have no idea if it'll work for you, but oh, go ahead with that. Good luck. on your own, be an expert overnight.
Right. And don't make a mistake either.
Right.
You can't, if you want to try something that's even slightly outside of a chemo or a radiation box, like you said, the doctors sort of say, okay, let us know how that goes. And so all of a sudden you're out there and you're trying to do something right and you have no idea if it could backfire either.
Right. Right. And you have to live with it. You have to live with it. One of the really, really important pieces of legislation we were talking about earlier, the importance of those, one really, really important one that went through the beginning of 2014 was a lot of the rallying. There was a lot of rallying around it at the CureFest the year before in 2013 was the Gabriella Miller Kids First Research Act. Mm-hmm. I know you had mentioned to us some things about it before, but this is something that needs continual support, right? I mean, I hear about her going to the Hill, regularly, trying to make sure that it succeeds.
Yeah, I think one of the most interesting and fruitful things that comes from that, in my opinion, is that there is money out there. There's money out there, but there's also money out there that's being used for, in my opinion, ridiculous reasons, such as funding these insane conventions and all of the things that go on there.
Yeah.
I would much rather see funding go toward pediatric cancer than to see all of the politicians in their fancy conventions. So personally, that's obviously my opinion. But what Gabriella's parents have done is they have made everybody aware that we can reallocate money. We can fight for change. We can make a difference for these kids. And we have to stick
there
with it,
enough.
And we have to work hard. And it is hard, and it takes so long, but if you continue the conversation and you keep pushing and you stay at it, it can be successful.
There's always money for what's a priority. Also.
Right. Yes.
And that's very important. And we have right now, again, I'm going to mention to people, please look at our advocacy page at jacksangels.org. Also go to kidsvcancer.org. And also at the Truth 365 has a full spread of the legislation that they support, the Truth365.org. The main one is the STAR Act. And they said at the Congressional Caucus Summit in September that they had a for sure we're going to get a vote on it. We don't have any guarantees on that. If they don't vote on it, it has to be reintroduced. Everything may have to be reintroduced. But we'd like a vote on the STAR Act, right? Before the end of this year. And so please encourage your representatives to support this legislation. As far as I know, the funding for the STAR Act is all it's not a political issue at all. It's not political money. And so there should be no political issue for your representative to support it, as far as I know. The Race for Children Act supports private sector incentives for funding the it's an update of PREA. Basically making an incentive for pediatric investment, pediatric research with the precision medicine. That is also, you can find that at Congressman McCall's website. He has the caucus actually is under him, under his website, their website. He's one of the co-chairs right now. But please check these things out because they affect us all. They affect the thousands of children to come who have yet to be diagnosed. They keep coming, steady stream of incidents. So this is, you know, though you may not be directly affected now, you very well could be someday, even indirectly, someone close to you. So it's not irrelevant. And one more that I always bring up is the National DIPG Awareness Resolution. It's just an awareness resolution. It doesn't allocate funds, but it does something that none of the other bills do. It asks for more consideration for the low survival rate cancers and for years of life lost, meaning our kids, with the NCI, which is our government research grant money. So that said, I always have to push the legislation, and especially because we're looking at a new administration next year. What do you see happening for CureFest next year? Do you encourage people to just become all the more involved? That's my gut feeling about it.
Well, we would certainly welcome any newcomers to CureFest. Yeah. It's a really fun festival on Sunday. We have an all-day event on Sunday from 10 to 4 on the National Mall on one of the panels right in front of the Capitol. And we have a 5K walk. There are usually upwards of 70 to 75 childhood cancer foundations that attend, and they line the National Mall in tents, and so you can sort of walk around and learn about the different things that they do and how they support children. We have a huge main stage where there's live music and dancing and children singing. We typically do have some medical doctors come, oncologists come and speak and give us some updates. So it's a just a very well-rounded day to raise awareness for childhood cancer. And then actually the day before, CureFest is actually a whole weekend event, but the day before on Saturday, this year we had a meet and greet on Freedom Plaza, which is right next to the White House on Pennsylvania Avenue. And then in the evening, we have a program where there are children who, again, perform. Some of them speak, some of them sing songs, they play their own music, guitars, that type of thing. We have a dance performance that is amazing. There's a local dance team that comes and performs. And then we have a candlelight vigil. So this year we had about 1,000 people registered to come and walk from Freedom Plaza up to the White House, and we have candles, and we sort of stand in front of the White House and hold this vigil, both in memory of the children that have been lost and also to continue that awareness campaign around childhood cancer. So we would certainly love for the event to continue growing. This year we were really excited. We got some really great sponsors this year, which were new to us. One of the most exciting relationships is with AFLAC. AFLAC, many people don't know this, but AFLAC has a childhood cancer center in Atlanta, and they have given over $100 million to childhood cancer in the last, wow. I don't know, I think 15, 20 years. I'm sure I don't know the exact timeline, but childhood cancer has actually been their charity of choice for so long, and their employees on a regular monthly basis put money toward childhood cancer research and funding. And so AFLAC was a major sponsor this year of CureFest, and we are hoping to continue that relationship with them for years to come.
That's wonderful. AFLAC.
It was great.
AFLAC.
You have to.
I love AFLAC. Oh my goodness, we have, my producers are telling me that I saw two minutes, now we're out. Emily, I hope you'll come back and talk to us more about this, what's coming this next year. It's been such an honor and pleasure to have you with me on the show today.
And thank you.
Yeah, let's keep in touch and keep the awareness going. We can't do it without you in our world, so thank you so much.
Well, thank you so much for the opportunity. I appreciate it. And thank you for everything you're doing for these kids.
More about Janet Demeter and her mission, visit jacksangels.org. As founder and president, Janet strives to assure that children with cancer and their parents have a voice, raising